Def Leppard story starts here in Sheffield. Back in 1978, when this used to be an engineering works, Steve Clark worked here as a lathe operator. Rick Savage was a trainee technician for British Rail. Rick Allen was still at school, and I used to work in the basement of a steel factory.
When I was about 13 or 14, we were starting to get bands, people that were interested in being in bands, just basically school kids. And we used to congregate at the youth club of Tapton School every Tuesday night. And basically, whoever had a guitar, whoever could play guitar, would come in and start playing. And we didn't really have any a band as such. It was just a congregation of people that were learning to play, whether it be drums, bass, or whatever. And from that, I got to know Pete Willis and a few other people that we decided, say, a year later, that we wanted to make something more, a little bit more serious out of it. Yeah. And I got in touch with, I'd known Tony Kenning, who had been playing drums for a couple of years. And between the three of us, we kind of started the nucleus of a band together. But we needed a singer. And nobody wanted to be a singer. It was like everybody wanted to play guitars, you know. So fortunately, Pete Willis knew Joe. And Joe, I think, had tried everything under the sun to be in a band. He'd tried playing drums, he'd tried playing guitar. And he just turned around to Peter one night, I think, and said, "Yeah, I'll sing." So Pete said, "Okay, fair enough." And that was the beginning of it, really.
Because we were interested in groups like Thin Lizzy, etc., with the sort of two guitarist thing, we decided we needed another guitarist, and again couldn't really find anybody until I bumped into Steve Clark at a technical college, and we got talking about, you know, guitars, etc., and that finished up with Steve coming down for an audition, and he joined that night.
Well, the good thing about Def Leppard when I joined is those first groups I'd been trying to find other musicians who had the same enthusiasm as myself. And they were very determined from the day one. They didn't sort of want to just go to the pub and then just say the verse for 30 minutes. They made it quite clear that every night we'd rehearse for 3 hours, then we'd have a drink after. And they were really enthusiastic about writing their own songs. They never just wanted to be a club band covering Thin Lizzy songs or top 20 hits to make a little bit of money on the side other than their day job. So it was very, the goals were set from day one. At one point, it got very desperate because I wanted to play so bad live, and that these guys, well, the rest of the guys in the group, just wanted to keep on rehearsing and polishing it and polishing it. And I said, well, I could be here in 10 years' time and still be rehearsing this bloody spoon factory. So one night, I probably had one like ale too many. I said, "Joe, if we don't do a gig soon, that's it. I'm going to find another group." And he was very good about it. He said, "All right, I guess that's it. We're going to do our first show," which turned into the Westfield School.
And this, amazingly, is it, the very hall. Of course, it's changed a little bit since we played here. The stage was actually here, and beyond this wall are the classrooms which we used as dressing rooms. We played for approximately 50 minutes, I think it was, which was helped a little bit by the fact that we smuggled in some beer in a bass drum. And one of the teachers that was overseeing the whole thing paid us out of his own pocket £5. And it was after doing about half a dozen shows in places like schools, pubs and clubs, that we decided that we wanted to make an EP. So we begged, borrowed and stole about 150 quid and we went off to Hull and recorded three tracks. This used to be a shop called Revolution Records. Well, it used to be owned by a guy called Pete Martin. And when we recorded our EP and we were looking for somewhere to distribute it, I came in here and said, "Any chance of you selling our record for us?" And he said, "Yeah, no problem."
And I proceeded to sort of like hand them out to our PR guys, you know, record company reps, promotion guys and things, to pass on to the A&R department. And Frank had a copy.
And I just played it at home in a few quiet minutes, and it was halfway through the B-side, which I can't remember the title of at the moment. It just dropped on me like a ton of bricks. It reminded me a bit of Yes, the early Yes from Fragile. And I phoned Pete up within about half an hour. I just sat there shaking for a while.
And Frank wanted Joe's address. I said, no, you're not having it, because I didn't think that Frank should manage the band. I didn't think he had the capabilities of doing it on his own. So, because he was a great PR guy, but he didn't know enough about the business. So, like, then Frank offered, he said, well, why don't we work together? You can do the music side and the hype and, you know, and all the other, you know, combined, we can more or less know enough to get it done and do a really good job.
Rick Allen was the next to join the band. Our first drummer, Tony Kenning, had left, and Frank Noon, who we borrowed for the EP, had rejoined his own group. So, we advertised.
So, when I saw this thing in the paper, I said, I'm not calling, I don't want to call, I'm sick of the whole thing, I want to pack in playing drums. So my father ended up calling, and I think he spoke with Joe, and shortly after that, I went down to the Limit Club, and we had a meeting in the gents' toilet. Sorry, I shouldn't say that. I've been in America too long. Yeah, I met Steve and Joe down there, and that was it. I'd basically got the gig. You know, they hadn't even heard me play. I said, well, do you want me to come down the rehearsal room or something? They said, oh, yeah, that's a good idea, yeah.
We needed press publicity, and the best-known rock magazine at the time was called Sounds. So we pestered their chief writer, Jeff Barton, to come and see us in Sheffield.
The demos that Joe had sent me down sounded, you know, very professional for a band of their particular youth. But obviously, seeing a band live is a whole different ballgame. But as soon as they came on stage, it was pretty obvious that there was something there, you know, something above and beyond your regular run-of-the-mill British heavy metal band. And that's not something you get every day of the week, you know. So I remember coming back down to town and talking to my then editor at the time, Alan Lewis, on Sounds, and said, I've just seen this great band, Alan. And Alan was always very, very receptive to new ideas and new bands. And because I guess he respected my opinion, he said, we'll put them on the cover. And I said, well, I don't know if they're necessarily ready for that, but let's do a very, very good center spread on the band. And so we did. And things seemed to take off from there.
We needed radio airplay too. And a disc jockey called Andy Peebles heard our EP in Frank Stewart Brown's car on a journey from Leeds to Manchester.
It's the old story, you get in a car, somebody's offering you hospitality, and inevitably, because they're in the business, the next line is, look, I've got this tape I'd like you to listen to. And Jeff Griffin, my then producer at Radio 1, and I both sort of looked at the ceiling of the car, the roof of the car, and went, oh no. And on goes the tape, because we couldn't really do anything else. And I mean, I'm very glad in hindsight that we did. And within about 12 bars of the first track we heard, which was Def Leppard in the very early days, Jeff and I were just looking at each other going, wow, or whatever came to mind. And we listened to about three or four songs, and to put it briefly, were immensely impressed with what we heard. As I said, the program encompassed all sorts of music, so I was quite happy to play the sort of music they were performing at the time, which, to be fair, hasn't changed that much, although it's much more sophisticated now. And at the end of a sort of conversation, after we'd listened to the four tracks, Frank said, what do you think? And Jeff Griffin said immediately, they're very, very good, and I'd be interested in inviting them down to the BBC studios in Maida Vale to record a session for us. And history will relate that that's exactly what we did.
I had to coordinate things so that the two fell together, so it was a question of keeping in touch with Jeff Barton as to when he was printing. And then keeping in touch with Jeff Griffin as to when he was going to broadcast a session. And we managed to get them to coincide, so that week we were having a track played every night on Radio 1, on Andy Peebles' show. And on the Thursday, which was obviously 3 days of Def Leppard airplay in, this lovely three-page centre spread, well, centre spread plus the next page, was in Sounds magazine. And after that, the record companies were just open doors.
And at one particular show at the Retford Porterhouse, it seemed to us that the entire music business was there to watch. One of these guys was Dave Bates from Phonogram.
People from A&M Records, Atlantic, CBS, and I think even EMI were up here that night. Interesting enough, of all the A&R people here, it was only the young ones, the scouts like myself, were the ones that were really impressed that night. The older guys were very dubious about it. The thing that surprised me, took me well back, is their age. I mean, they were so young. The drummer obviously had never shaved in his life, and come to think of it, I've got a feeling the bass player probably never shaved either. They looked sort of 16, and later I discovered that that's exactly what they were. They were 15 to sort of 17 years old. And they really meant it. And to see kids this age just come in on stage with so much force and so much belief in what they were doing was startling. My personal desire was to find a band that would sell records in America, and the little note rang that said maybe this could be the band that does it.
Having met them as individuals, not in a performing environment, one was impressed with their determination and their down-to-earthness. And then when I saw them live, it was a combination of all those factors. It's very difficult to crystallize exactly what ingredients convince somebody in my position are sufficient to invest in a band like this. But it was, I think, their ability to communicate with an audience. I think that was this indefinable quality they had. And that only really came home when one saw them live. That crystallized all those things I've said. And one saw in front of one something that was very, really very exciting and novel and fresh. And I was tremendously excited. So much so that I said to them and their parents, because technically they were minors, at least some of them were minors at the time, that if it transpired that it wasn't possible for our company to sign them at that time, I would certainly use my best endeavors to help them get on, because I felt they deserved it.
But in the end, we did sign a recording contract with Phonogram for a six-figure sum.
On our first British tour, supporting Sammy Hagar in September 1979, we were initiated into the wacky world of rock and roll with our first fight.
All I remember is stopping at an off-license in Sheffield, buying a litre bottle of white wine, and then I proceeded to drink the whole thing on the way up to Newcastle, passed out halfway up the motorway. And then all I remember is waking up in traffic, and obviously the van was going, you know, to and fro sort of thing. And I started feeling my stomach was like, I'm going like, guys, can we stop? They said, no, Rick, we're right in the middle of traffic now. We're right in the middle of Newcastle, we can't. I said, guys, you've got to stop. You've got to stop now. Anyway, it was too late, and they had this sort of plywood partition down the side of the van, and I just threw my ring up down the side of the van, that was it.
And Andy, the driver, had been ordered by Pete Martin to clean this up. Now, Andy refused to do it, and I can't say I don't blame him, and I sort of stuck up for him and said, well, you know, I think Rick should clean his own mess up.
Anyway, things built up, and I was really annoyed at such a stupid little thing. I mean, it was more important for them to be ready to get on stage than be messing about with some guy. So, no, I'm not going to put my hand down there and get that stuff. Eventually, I had a bit of a do with Joe.
Basically, me and Pete Martin came to blows about 2 minutes before we went on stage. I had a black eye and he had a bruised stomach.
I was really, really incensed. But, like, on the other side of the coin, I knew myself after that incident that we weren't going to keep them. You know, it was obvious that for the first time I'd seen an ego involved in problems, and I just thought, well, you know, this isn't going to last. I mean, that was the start of the end.
I was working as an A&R man at Mercury Records in Chicago. Phonogram Records, which was, it's our sister company. Mercury is owned by Polygram. They sent over a copy of the EP and said, we're signing this group, Def Leppard. So I put it on, listened to it, was bowled over by it, loved it quite a bit, and I immediately telexed back to them to to the UK that they had my full support, and the American company would be happy to release the record at the same time as the English company.
Little did we know that while we were getting started in Britain, Cliff Bernstein and Peter Mensch, who was then with Lieber Krebs Management in New York, were making plans to take over our future careers.
I first heard about Def Leppard when my partner, Cliff Bernstein, who was a Mercury Records A&R man, called me up and said to me, "Mensch, I've heard this great tape. You've got to go off and find this band for management. I don't care if they have managers. Steal them from another set of managers. The truth will come out now. This is late in our career." So I really trotted off to England, and I sort of put them on a tour I was booking with a group called AC/DC. And everybody said, "Well, don't worry, Peter. Within five shows, they'll ask you to manage them." And they did.
I approached Peter, and I asked him to come up to the dressing room just to listen to what our old management team were talking about, because they just couldn't agree on anything. So Peter said, "No way, I'm not doing that." You know, he said, "I don't want to be seen to be involved at all." But we managed to persuade him just to come up and stand outside the dressing room, and he said, "You're right. These guys haven't got a clue." So I guess I played quite a role in getting Peter introduced to the band, you know, which was nice.
They were almost like kid brothers that we really wanted to protect from the evils of the industry. So much so that we really didn't see what was going on anymore in terms of people wanting to get through us to the band. So Lieber Krebs Management, who'd done the same thing the year before to AC/DC's Australian manager, had been coming in through the back door.
I don't have to be careful in talking about Cliff Bernstein and Peter Mensch. They're both expert at what they do. And on the other side of the coin, if I'd been in their position, I'd have done exactly the same. That's what the business is all about. It's cutthroat. And you know that if you play men's rule, men's games, you've got to play by men's rules.
First thing I did was just go and see a solicitor.
Well, let's see, the ethics of it, I guess, really weren't very clean. I thought I could do a better job, frankly, if you want the truth. And I thought it was really important, you know, for the act to become successful. If it took my presence to do it, then I was going to do not anything. Listen, if they could never have made a settlement with MSB, I never would have managed the act.
I don't know how ethical it is to let people of talent like that and at that age just be kind of thrown into the waters, and you know, if they swim fine, if they drown, tough luck. Somehow the five guys meant more to me than the two managers.
On Through the Night, our first album, was released in March 1980, and on the back sleeve we took the opportunity of thanking as many people as possible that had helped us up to that part of our career.
There was Andy Peebles, big thanks to everybody, people from the record company, everybody had really had a hand in over the year, except Pete and Frank. And that hurt.
Have they ever said thanks? I don't think so.
To be quite honest with you, we'd had such a tough time negotiating our way out of the contract, we just weren't in the mood to say thanks.
So, we'll get him in the end. That's all I can say.
By this time, we'd completed four British tours, playing everywhere from Aberdeen to Aberystwyth. Now it was time to broaden our horizons.
Musicians first and foremost, and they put on a great show for everybody. And I think that they're really serious about their music and serious about pleasing their fans.
I'm more attracted to the look of the band. I mean, I'm really impressed with the look. I think Joey Elliott is very attractive. A lot of the groups, they look like, you know, they might be druggies or something like that, and they're not that way.
Their sound is just real attractive to a lot of different audiences. Of course, with the band being so good-looking, you know, that definitely pulls the women towards them, but their music is the main attraction.
Because they are a couple years older than us, maybe. So we got into them really young, and we grew up right up with them. So that has a lot of meaning for us.
The guitar work is top-notch. The drumming is great. The vocals, you know, Joe Elliott's got vocals like nobody else. And I think that is main reason why they're, you know, so big over here.
Q105, always there at all the really big concerts.
Q105, Gloria Johnson, and we have made it. We are at the Coliseum backstage, and Joe Elliott of Def Leppard is here. Welcome back, Joe.
This lady I'm talking to actually was the first person ever in America to play a Def Leppard song on the radio.
Oh, Joe.
Can you remember?
I can remember.
What makes you the coolest person in America?
Oh.
I first remember hearing about Def Leppard in about February or March of 1980 when I was on vacation and had flown to New York City to see family. I stopped off at Cliff Bernstein's office, whom I'd known since the mid-70s when he used to be a record promoter, and now he was managing bands. So I stopped by his office and he said, Gloria, you've got to hear this band. I've just signed them, they're wonderful. He gave me a test pressing of Def Leppard's first album, which is very special to me. I have it still right here. And subsequently got the band to sign it for me. But this is the first I heard of Def Leppard. He gave it to me and said, what do you think? You know, give it a listen. When you get back to Portland, I'll give you a call, let me know. I took it with me on vacation, played it the first time and was totally knocked out, played it over and over and over again. So by the time I got back to Portland a week later, I knew every song and all the lyrics to all the songs and was totally knocked out by the band and put it on the radio. And we started with the song Hello America, appropriately enough for Def Leppard. And a couple of months later, they came to town and played and proved that they could do it live too. They had that hard rock beat and that hard rock bass rhythm section, but they also had wonderful vocals. It wasn't just one singer, they could all sing, and it was, you know, harmonies, and it was bright, and it was new, and it was very exciting. Besides the music, I think the image was, it was a time when a lot of the rock stars were getting older and America loves youth, and they were young and they were good looking, and we just fell in love with them right away.
In August 1980, after 11 weeks of touring America, we came back to Britain to play the Reading Festival. We didn't go down very well. In fact, we had things thrown at us, beer cans, mud, you name it. This, as far as I'm concerned, was due to a certain element of the British rock press falsely accusing us of selling out to the American market.
I suppose I did feel slightly embittered. I felt I'd been used as a stepping stone, as a lever to further their career, basically. And I don't know, maybe somewhat naively, I kind of thought I had a relationship with the band that was slightly closer than that. So anyway, feeling, you know, rather pissed off, to say the least, I subsequently wrote another article basically voicing my disenchantment with the band and saying, you know, look, these guys have sold out to America. Well, the band certainly did have a rough time at the Reading Festival. I can remember having a stand-up argument with the manager, Peter Mensch, backstage while the band were performing.
Def Leppard have never made any pretense about what they were, which is sort of a very melodic, hard rock band that looked good, right? Simple. They were that before Jeff Barton discovered them, they were that after Jeff Barton discovered them, and the fact they made this record and went to America after they'd done these two English tours were mind-boggling, that people would turn around on them so quickly. I've never seen it happen before in my life. I hope to never see it again. It was awful.
I remember feeling, you know, a little bit sad for them at that particular festival, and I felt a bit guilty as well, having perhaps, you know, been part and parcel of creating this bad situation for them.
For our second album, High and Dry, we employed the talents of Mutt Lange as producer. We tried to get Mutt to do the first album, but he was unavailable. And when we finally managed to nail him down for the second, little did we know what we had in store. We were about to learn what you really had to do to make a good record.
Mutt Lange, to me, is a genius. He's the kind of person that He's a great performer in his own right, but he's also great at handling people, you know, that which makes him the ideal producer.
To say he's a perfectionist would be an understatement of the century. He's the kind of guy that pushes you and pushes you and pushes you for the maximum performance that you could possibly give. There's a term that we often use in the studio, fix it in the mix.
This doesn't work with Mutt. You have to get it right on tape. It has to be right on tape. It has to be the best performance you could ever give.
But that's what you've got to do. You've got to work hard. You can't do it in 10 hours a day. Mutt Lange is there 20 hours a day, every day, you know, which I admire him for.
Things seemed to go a hell of a lot smoother after we met up with Mutt. You know, he took us from being a sort of an average sort of band to being something, you know, like we are now.
They came in with these songs that had bits that were good. And so essentially the point I was trying to make to them is don't fall in love with what you bring, because we're going to change it a hell of a lot, if not totally. And even if that idea just sparks us onto something totally different, we end up with a completely different thing. And that was the thing that I really tried to instill into them, was just that openness. Completely don't fall in love with anything until we all agree that that's the best idea. Gypsy, sitting looking pretty. A lot of rock and roll is average. It's very cliché. I'm not saying that we're any better, but so we would then just try and take these songs and base them on what we perceived were to be the actual rock classics, you know, like the great rock hits of all time. And we just, and I'd just say, listen, we would then try and raise the standard of that song up to actually be as good as one of these rock classics. And so we would just hone and hone and hone, you know, until the music itself was right. And then even putting the guitars down, obviously being a musician myself, I would get the arrangements right, make sure the feel was right, and I could just really just help them actually get every part right.
By the middle of 1982, we were halfway through our third album, Pyromania, and it was becoming increasingly obvious to us that we had a problem with Pete Willis. Pete being the kind of guy he was, very shy, he needed a drink to get him on stage, and now he needed a drink to get him in the studio.
Well, I did find myself drinking, you know, and, you know, after a while, sort of more or less every night, sort of thing. But it wasn't the actual, you know, amount I was drinking. It's just that when I'd had a drink, I'd want to get into this, you know, sort of deep conversation about, you know, why don't we need to worry about who we're going to get to do this and when we're going to do this, and we haven't, let's get some songs, and, you know, which is, I never actually used to mention them that much, because people used to turn around and say, well, you know, that's what the job entails, you know, people have to worry about the job. I don't know, it seemed to just probably be going a bit fast for me. Maybe that's the thing.
One morning, I mean, I could smell him from about 50 yards back. He was gone, man. I mean, I thought it was quite funny, actually, but they were warned not to drink. And he came in and he literally could not play, you know. And we thought he was joking. He duck, duck. It was a solo we were doing, and he hit these notes, and he couldn't even find the neck almost. And I'd literally had to just tell him. We tried the take again, and I said, Pete, listen, you're going to have to go back to Sheffield and just cool out and come back when you've actually got yourself together.
Mutt Langer was getting more and more upset with him, and he was mouthing off at Mutt, and Pete was in no position to mouth off at who we considered the world's best producer. And the fact was is that the band called me up and said, we've got to get rid of Pete Wells. They used to call me up about everybody. We've got to get rid of this guy. We've got to get rid of that guy. Come on, just stop talking about this. You know, these all people, you know, it's key to Def Leppard, all these people. They said, this has gone too far. Mutt's fed up with him, right? You know, we're fed up with him. He's drinking forever. You know, we've got to get rid of him. I said, okay, if you're going to get rid of him, then you're going to get rid of him, right? I'm not going to be your hatchet man. He was a founder member of this band. You're going to all sit down in my living room, as it happened, confronting him, and say, Pete, you're gone. You know, I don't even want to be in the room because I think it's something that should come from the band itself. I'm not the hatchet man. I never will be for any of my bands. So they said, okay, all right, if you insist, we'll do it. And they did. You know, I gave them a lot of brownie points for that.
I was on the dole, you know, for a couple of years, which is a bit disheartening, actually, when you've got an album at number two in the States, you know, and you can't convince the bank manager to lend you sort of 200 quid or something like that. But, you know, that's not their fault.
I didn't know that Pete Wills was on the dole, frankly, but the same time is that he got money when we got money. I mean, the answer was simply, we didn't make any money either, right? As soon as there was money in there, he got it. I mean, we took care of Pete Willis. He got his full share on Pyromania. I mean, he's probably still making money from it.
Maybe if you'd asked me a year after leaving Def Leppard what I thought about it, it may have been a different answer, but, you know, no, it's worked out well all round. It's got me into the business, and now at least I have the options in front of me to be able to carry on and do it as a career sensibly.
Joe Elliott, in his desire to fire everybody in the band at one time or another, I won't count to that right now, always said, we could get Phil Collin in the band to replace Pete Wells. And we had met him before, right, because he played in a local London band called Girl, and he was young, and he was interesting, and he was a good guitar player, or so I thought, although Girl were not a very good rock band. And so the minute, you know, Joe and the band decided to fire Pete Wells, they said, we've got to hire Phil Collin. I said, okay, let's do that, but at the same time, let's go down, bring him down to the studio, and have Mutt sort of test him out on some songs to play guitar, because I'm not going to do anything until Mutt Langer says this guy's a good player. And a week later, Mutt calls back and says, at least to me, he goes, he can play, he's really good. In fact, he's better than anybody in the band.
I knew all the people in the band, so there was no question of like having to become comfortable with anyone, because we just knew each other. And it was just like hanging out, really. It was like being at school or something, you know, like a organised school outing or whatever. It was just fun. Now, I was in a two-guitar band anyway, this band Girl. So I didn't have to get used to like playing with another guitarist or anything, because I'd have already been like experienced with it and everything. When I met Mutt Langer, actually, my playing changed, because he's a producer in such a way that he makes it play a lot better. And when I came into the studio first time, I just started playing like I normally do, and he goes, no, no, no. You know, it's like just out of time. I wasn't even aware of it at the time. He just improved my playing 100%. I mean, he does that to everyone that he works with. He's great. He's definitely the best producer around, I think. Songwriting's always a big thing. You know, I do a lot of that. Come up with some of the melody ideas, some lyric ideas as well, here and there. It's like, no one's limited in the band, actually. No one says, like, well, you're the singer, so you can't come up with a guitar riff, or you're the guitar player, so you can't come up with a vocal. Everyone does their bit, you know, and we get what's the best and just use that. It's kind of weird. That's why it takes so long, and us especially, to get anything sorted out. You know, it's five people, and everyone's got to agree on something. But it usually turns out well in the end.
Yeah, right!
Pyromania took over 11 months to record and put the band well over £700,000 in debt. So you can imagine, we needed nerves of steel at this point in our career. But one thing that we did have going for us was the fact that in America, and only in America, they have 24-hour rock and roll radio stations that were playing tracks from the High and Dry album. There was also a new phenomenon on TV called music television, better known to you and me as MTV. They were also playing the promos from the High and Dry album. This primed our audience slightly, and by the time Pyromania was complete and released, it went on to sell over 7 million albums. One of the worst things you could ever imagine happening to a band happened to us on New Year's Eve 1984.
I took my girlfriend out up to the Lady Bower Reservoir just to show her the sights and everything. And as I was driving back down the road, back down to the A57, down to the main road, this Alfa Romeo came flying round the corner and overtook me on the bridge. So I just sort of carried on about my own business. But this guy ended up slowing down, so I caught up to him. And every time I wanted to try and overtake this guy, he would put his foot down. I'm going like, oh, I can't deal with this at all, you know. And Miriam's sitting there going, don't lose your temper, don't lose your temper. I'm going, no, I'm fine, you know. But this went on for about 4 miles. So I kind of lost my rag a little bit. And with it being a left-hand drive car, you know, obviously driving on the left-hand side of the road, when I finally did punch the accelerator, I didn't see this left-hand turn, and I ended up breaking my car in a big way. And I think the seatbelt actually took my arm off. It came unclipped and just came across my chest, and just took it off. And I think the arm stayed in the car, and I left via the sunroof. But apparently I was conscious for the whole thing, and I think that's what actually saved my life in the end.
The accident happened on the A57 Manchester Road at Mosca on the moors above Sheffield. Rick's car failed to negotiate a sharp bend, went out of control and collided with a wall, rolling onto its roof. The wreckage of his car, a powerful Corvette Stingray, bears witness to the force of the crash. Rick was thrown through the windscreen, his left arm completely severed. His Dutch fiancée, Miriam Barrensden, suffered head injuries. She was dragged clear of the car by rescuers. At the Royal Hallamshire Hospital, surgeons spent 4 hours sewing his arm back on, but it'll be some days yet before they know whether the microvascular surgery has been successful.
God, I never thought I'd be doing this again. It's a day just like today. God, this place is bleak. I've got the strangest feeling in my stomach. It's a good job it was a soft landing, eh? Hey, that corner. Sure. Surprised I didn't hurt myself more than what I did. Can you get a feel for this place?
The last thing I remember was standing up in this field and just looking down and saying, I'm never gonna play drums again, ever. Where's my arm gone? And that was it. That's the last thing I remember. I'm sorry, I'm kind of lost for words in a way.
When I heard the news of what had happened, I sat down on a stool and physically cried my eyes out for about 4 hours till I couldn't cry anymore. I rang the rest of the guys, they're all in the same boat. None of us knew what to do. We had no idea whether he'd live or die. We had no idea if he'd ever play the drums again. I mean, after all, who's ever heard of a one-armed drummer?
When I arrived at the hospital, he was actually, I could see that he was really down. I mean, he was trying to keep a pretty brave face, but he was prostrate. I mean, really prostrate at that point, not knowing which limbs were going to work at all. And then I just mentioned to him that that he could, conceivably, if he could get his right hand to work again, he could actually play the drums by repeating the sounds on the top and the bottom. And he then, as he lay there, he started just doing that thing with his limbs. And I could actually see almost a light shine, you know, in his eyes, in terms of that. He thought, yeah, that's actually the one way out of it, you know. And literally from that day on, in my perception, the few times I saw him, he had a cause. And then I actually mentioned it to the band. And I said to Peter Manchin, I said, Rick really could play. You know, if it's just going to take time. We were going to record the album, so he had a lot of recuperative time. And of course, nobody was discounting that, but in the back of everyone's minds, they weren't quite ready to believe it.
First time I got out of bed, I sort of held on. And then the first time I let go, I literally flew towards the right-hand side of the room and just hit the wall, and that was the thing that stopped me. Whoa, hang on a minute. I don't think you realize how heavy, you know, an arm is. And it was quite a strange sensation. I ended up sort of walking around the room going, heavy, light, heavy, light, heavy, you know, and that was it. Strange.
All the time he was just playing in his bed, in his mind. He was trying to coordinate his limbs. And the very first time he could actually, then he got onto some local Sheffield guy who got the process going, who got him some makeshift pedals together and everything, and he started getting it right. And he would just come into all of us every now and again and say, what do you think of this? And you go, or something. You go, great, Rick, you know. But apart from just getting that together, he actually had to create rhythm, you know, and be as powerful as he was. And he did it. I mean, he did it on his own, completely.
It's literally two drum kits combined. It's a series of electronic pads and a series of pedals. So I use my left foot on all the pedals. Obviously, I use my right foot on the kick drum as I always did. And with my right hand, I play the pads. So you're sort of playing pretty much everything I used to play with my left arm, I'm playing with my left foot now. And it's literally just playing opposites like that.
Today, probably as good or better as he was before the accident. The man has never done a bad gig. He plays a great show every time he goes out there. If anything, maybe because he feels the loss of the arm, he plays maybe more intently now, more focused than he ever did before. And when you go to see a Def Leppard show today, a live show, you may be thinking for the first 30 seconds of the first song, if you're a fan, you're thinking, well, I'm going to watch this guy who's a one-armed drummer. And I guarantee you, after the first 30 seconds, you've forgotten about it. He's just a drummer, and he's a damn good one.
So then it was back to the studio to finish the album that would eventually be called Hysteria. When it was finally released in August of 1987, it was over 4.5 years since the release of Pyromania, and we were genuinely concerned that the fans just wouldn't care anymore.
We're live at the Q102 bringing the weekend party at Sam's Cafe. That's at the corner of Maple and McKinney. This next album was one of the biggest albums ever in the United States in the last 6 years. It comes from Def Leppard. It's from Hysteria. This is Love Bites on Q102. And that is from Hysteria. That sucker sold millions, almost like 10 million worldwide. That's Love Bites on Q102.
When Hysteria first came out, my particular radio station, when we heard it, we said, this is unbelievable. There's 12 songs on the CD, and we're going to play 10 of them immediately, what we call out of the box. Immediately, we heard 10 songs out of 12. That's unheard of. The biggest albums in the world, we might play 4 songs from the CD over the life, maybe 4 or 5 songs maximum over the life of the album. When I heard Hysteria, I said, there's 10 songs here. You know, 10 songs here to work with, to play, to share with the audience. It's a cornucopia. It's a banquet of great music.
We have, in a way, 2 generations of rock fans now that are big Def Leppard fans. And maybe because of the cumulative effect, I think, you know, here, maybe the whole is more than the sum of the parts. Give them a brilliant album like Hysteria with a brilliant album like Pyromania that's 4 years old, and a High and Dry album that was quite good, which is now close to 2 million sales. There's the cumulative effect of all this, in which Def Leppard now are more a historic kind of band than just the band of the moment.
The Hysteria Tour is the single most difficult thing we've ever attempted. In over 14 months, we traveled through Japan, all of Europe, all of America, and all of Canada. Not once did I touch an alcoholic drink. But 225 shows later, I think it's fair to say that all of us were pretty much physically and mentally shattered.
The great thing about being on stage is that you can fulfill all your private ambitions all at once. It's like, you're almost another person, as such. You can do whatever you want, provided you're still delivering what people that paid money want to see. You can do almost anything you want, and know that not that you can get away with it as such, but it's just, you can forget about everything, you can just totally relax, and it's the greatest feeling.
Can't sell 12 million records and not earn any money, but it can create some very weird situations with friends and people you used to know. For example, you could walk into a pub and see old schoolmates, and you can offer everybody around to drinks, and you're the rich kid who's throwing his money around. If you don't buy everybody around, you'd buy one for yourself, then you're the stingy person, you know. So I think it's just having respect for it and just learning to adjust.
Of course, people are always saying to me, what are you going to do when you grow up? Well, by that, I suppose they mean, can you still see yourself doing this in 10 years' time? My answer to that is yes, I can. We could still split up tomorrow, though. Who knows?
Due to what we've actually been through as a band, we could literally go on for as long as we want to. As long as people have got the interest, then Def Leppard are always going to be around.
If Michael Jackson can sell 40 million or whatever, I honestly don't believe that it's not a fluke. There are billions of people in this world. And if you make, the way we've always looked at the Leppard music is it's, if we can actually learn the craft of writing songs and improve that craft, which is what all of us are trying to do. I mean, every member of that band is actually coming in with good songs now. If not good songs, at least a quarter of a good song. So that's something they never had before. So I can actually see their graph, if the same kind of concentration and intent is put into the thing, I can see the graph going up still further, really.
It doesn't always happen with the band that you manage, but in this case, these guys, you know, they're worth it. It's fun watching them grow up. It's a whole different thing. Now they've become more like me than I am. It's scary. They all have credit cards and stuff like that. I've created a monster.